Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brothers and sisters, welcome to another episode of Sapient Thoughts, where we discuss theophilosophical issues, where we answer contentions raised against Islam, and where we provide a robust and clear and unequivocal case for Islam. In today's episode, which is one part of a multi-part series, we are going to be continuing on the topic of worldview. In the last episode, we discussed the definition of a worldview, and we saw that a worldview is that conceptual framework that a person has by which they interpret the world. And at the end of the last episode, we asked the question, does everyone have a worldview? Now, the answer is that yes, indeed, every single person has a worldview. And one can compare it to a language in the sense that every single person has a language that they use to either communicate in or think in or hear and listen, etc. So just like a person that they adopt a language non-reflectively, they don't think much about it and they grow up like this, similarly, a person might adopt a worldview and not really give it much critical thought. Now, whereas when it comes to languages, a person having a particular language or speaking one particular language over another may not have any sort of deep consequences when it comes to ethics and morals and when it comes to one's afterlife or when it comes to understanding those deeper existential questions about why are we here, where are we going, and what happens when we die, etc. But a worldview does have those consequences and does shape exactly our opinions and our ideas and so on and so forth. Now the thing is, when a person is able to speak more than one language, they have a deeper understanding of the commonalities between languages, and most certainly they have a understanding of the differences in languages. So if someone happens to come from a bilingual household, or let's say one person is brought up and the society around that person speaks, let's say, English, but in the household they speak another language, and so they're able to have two languages by which they're able to navigate communication, that person can see that, okay, well, there are some similarities. Languages, both of these languages have certain commonalities. They both have nouns and verbs and adjectives and so on and so forth. But how they're structured and how they come together and how they are used to express something are very different. The ability to compare one language to another empowers a person to be able to really critically look at their language and see the different structures. So for instance, if a person can speak English and they can speak Arabic, they can see that, okay, well, both languages have some commonalities. Both languages have nouns and verbs and adjectives and so on and so forth, but how the sentences or structures would be different. For instance, in Arabic, you can have verbal sentences and nominal sentences, whereas in English, you have just nominal sentences or sentences that start with a noun, unless, of course, you're Yoda, right? So a verbal sentence would be something like a Yoda sentence, like going to the market, are we? But in Arabic, that's pretty common. You can actually use that. Now, seeing these differences, one is able to then look and judge the particular language and see like what are some of the benefits, what are some of the strengths of one language, what are some of the weaknesses of another, and so on and so forth. Now again, adopting one language or another doesn't have any sort of real world consequences when one thinks about ethics and morals and basically one's own salvation and so on and so forth. But yet adopting a worldview does have those consequences and has profound implications when one thinks about questions that they may ask. And specifically in the realm of Islam, when someone has a question about Islam, it has profound ramifications. So, when we think about a worldview, we can understand it like a language. Or another way to look at it is that every single human being has a direction. So, right now, I'm facing you, or rather facing the camera in this case, but every person has a direction in which they face. And so, if you think about yourself right now, you're either looking at the screen that this video is playing on, or you're looking somewhere else. But the point is, you're looking somewhere. Everyone has a direction. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala highlights this. And he says, وَلِكُلِّ وِجْهَةٌ هُوَ مُوَلِّيهَا, that everyone has a direction in which they turn. Now, this particular verse in the Qur'an is referring to the qibla, the direction in which the Muslim would turn to pray. Now, the exegetes have some interesting things to say about this particular verse. Even though it is referring to a qibla, the direction of prayer, but in general, the way the sentence is structured and what we can take from the sentence is that everyone has a direction. So, what do some of the exegetes say? Well, one of the exegetes writes, this is Muhammad Shafi, writes in Ma'arif al-Quran, he says it is, as the commentators point out, an observable fact that every traditional community has had a religious orientation of its own, whether appointed by Allah or chosen by itself. Everyone has an orientation. Now here, he uses the term religious orientation. And I wanted to just spend a minute here and comment upon this. Because what we find is that when we speak about worldviews, we somehow tend to think that you have worldviews, which are kind of all-encompassing perhaps, and then you have a part of that which is religion. However, when we bring into our conversation the Arabic word or the word that's used in the Quran, the term deen, we can say that this concept or this word deen can be overlapped or can be used as a means to understand worldviews. What do I mean? Well, many times when the term is translated in the Quran, it's translated as religion. And so hence you have Muhammad Shafi, who mentions in Ma'arif al-Quran that every traditional community has a religious orientation. But what we have to understand is that pre-modern societies, when they spoke about religion, it was religion that delimited and delineated the area of the secular. Whereas in the modern world, it is the secular that delimits and gives boundaries to the religious. From the point of view of the term deen, as it's used in the Quran, what we can see is that it includes whichever scenario you're in as this overarching worldview. Now, of course, there may be some contentious area. Other people might translate it as something else, keep it as religion, and so on and so forth. But that's outside the scope of this particular video. My point is that its usage in the Quran and its usage, you know, when we read it and we're reading texts that are talking about this term, we can apply to it the idea of a worldview for many reasons. For instance, the term, as it's used in Surah Yusuf, when speaking about the king, talks about Dinul Malik. And now, you wouldn't translate that as religion of the king, because in that context, it's speaking about the rules and regulations that the king has established for his entire kingdom. So it's not speaking about his religion per se. Again, in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the ayah, هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى وَالدِّينِ الْحَقِّ لِيُذْهِرَهُ عَلَى دِينِ كُلِّ, that he is the one who has sent his messenger, هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى, with guidance, وَالدِّينُ الْحَقِّ, and the true deen, لِيُذْهِرَهُ عَلَى دِينِ كُلِّ, in order to overcome and manifest over all other deens. Now, here, to apply the term religion and limit the term to religion only is not really a correct way of looking at the term itself. Now, again, this discussion, you know, it's outside the scope, but the idea when people are speaking about religion, we have to understand the idea of religion from a pre-modern worldview or a pre-modern vantage point and a modern vantage point. So that being said, this comment that we get from Ma'arif al-Quran, it is, the commentators point out, an observable fact that every traditional community has had a religious orientation of its own. You could read into that a deen orientation or a worldview orientation, a view of the world, has an orientation when it comes to a framework by which you understand the world. Okay, the very famous exegete, Ibn Kathir, he mentions, Al-Awfi reported that Ibn Abbas said, وَلِكُلِّ وِجْهَةٌ هُوَ مُوَلِّيهَا, that for everyone, there's a direction that everyone turns. He said, this talks about the followers of the various religions. Here, read worldview or deen. For every nation and tribe has its own qibla, has its own direction, which they choose, while Allah's appointed qibla is what the believers face. Now, he continues on. He mentions a few things, comments, and says that Abu Aliya mentions that the Jew has a direction which he faces, the Christian has a direction to which he faces, and Allah has guided you, O Muslims, to a qibla, which is the true qibla. Now he continues on, and then he mentions another verse of the Quran, and this is what I wanted to point out here. And that verse is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لِكُلِّنْ جَعَلْنَا مِنْكُمْ شِرْعَةً وَمِنْهَاجًا. And to everyone, we have made a law and a method. Now, let's understand this, or let's dig a bit deeper. There is a law and a method. When we think about a worldview and how, like, our frame of reference for understanding the world around us, what we have in terms of a law and what we deem to be legal and illegal has a source or is dependent upon one's worldview. And so just like there's a direction that everyone turns, and you can't do without a direction, similarly, that direction is going to determine one's law and one's method for understanding that law, understanding things like morals and ethics and so on and so forth. And so just like everyone has a direction that they turn, you cannot be directionless, just like everyone has a language that they are, you know, brought up speaking or they're communicating with or they're thinking in, similarly, every single person has a worldview. Now, what are the main components of a worldview? So if we've understood a worldview, and we've understood that everyone has a worldview, then much like someone who's bilingual and wants to analyze one language compared to another, there are certain building blocks or certain components of a worldview. Just like there are certain components which all languages share, and then there's differences. So similarly, there are certain components that all worldviews share, and then we use those components to compare and contrast worldviews. So what are those main components? In the next episode, that's what we're going to be looking at. What are the main components of a worldview? So until next time, this is Fahad Tasleem, and these are Sapient Thoughts.